Hello, prospects. I'm Jonathan Pruitt. This is Jim Davis, and we have such an exciting offer for you today. Think about it. Underground, natural heating, 8 bedrooms, 20,000 square feet, built-in security. Neighbors are a little noisy, but it's nothing that you can't handle for the low, low price of all of your resources and money. You can have your very own dungeon designed by Jim Davis on WebDM.
Fear ye all who missed Dwarven Forge's Hellscape Kickstarter. Complete with illuminated lava and infernal decor, this miniature table gaming terrain is full of all of the evil your life has been missing. Live now on Kickstarter.
They know the devil is in the details, and that's why Dwarven Forge's terrain is hand-painted and hand-sculpted. On the night that I got my first sets, I stayed up until 3 playing with them. Made different rooms, different NPCs to go in the rooms, traps, tricks, puzzles, treasures. It was great. And every time I've broken them out since then, I'm inspired to make new dungeons, even with the same old sets.
Let me tell you, folks. The first time I put together WebDM's castle, I felt like a kid with his Lego and his imagination, ready to build the world. Kickstarter ends on July 1st. Click the link here or in the description.
Okay, Jim, silly question. What are we talking about today?
I think we're going to be talking about dungeons. We got some fun toys from our friends at Dwarven Forge, and we've put them together in a way that hopefully will illustrate the points that we're going to talk about, because this is really fun.
Yeah.
But apart from all of the bells and whistles here and this dungeon that now I have to make and play, even though all of its secrets are laid bare, we're going to use it to illustrate something as we talk about just sort of like dungeons and ways to craft a dungeon that you can get through in a single session and still have it be a fun and engaging sort of experience.
Well, let me start at the basics.
Sure.
Might have talked about it before a little bit, but it doesn't hurt to brush over. What are some of the different types of dungeons that a DM could draw from when they're thinking about what kind of dungeon do I want?
So, like, I think everybody's familiar with the mega dungeon concept, right? Mega dungeons have been around since the beginning of the hobby. They've recently received sort of a resurgence, both sort of through the OSR and then sort of trickling into the mainstream hobby. Of course, the culmination of this, the one that everybody's probably familiar with, is Dungeon of the Mad Mage, the Waterdeep module. Mm-hmm. Which is like, you can spend your entire 1 through 20 career inside this dungeon and, you know, still have plenty of adventure, not exhaust the possibilities of it. And that's a fun way to play. Like, I have both run and played in a mega dungeon style campaigns. The potential for, say, burnout on the DM's part is pretty high. The potential for burnout on both the player's side is pretty high, because maybe they just get tired of doing, you know, checking at doors and looking for traps and doing that.
Yeah, covering the same ground multiple times.
Right. And so maybe you don't want to tackle something that big. You don't want to have a potentially endless or limitless dungeon. You don't want something that's going to be too much or too intimidating or like put your players off. But you also want something that's still going to be engaging, still features some of the best elements of a mega dungeon, which is a rewarding of repeated visits and like a layering of secrets and a changing environment onto it. I think it's possible to do that with a smaller dungeon.
Yeah.
And it's worth like looking at those principles and applying them to different types.
Although now that I'm thinking about like a dungeon that you spend all 20 levels in and immediately go to Blam.
Show, sure,
which is
right,
basically
yeah.
like they grew up in a dungeon.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be a fun world to be in.
I mean, that's kind of what the Underdark is, right?
Yeah.
Like, the Underdark is a worldwide mega dungeon. It's an interesting concept, but it is intimidating. And if you're starting out, or if you're new, or if you've got new players, or if you just don't want to be, like, locked into a specific campaign mode for that long, then, you know, just steal the best parts and, like, maybe leave your, you know, 3-ring binder worth of mega dungeon on the shelf.
Right. Okay, so you're going to make a dungeon.
Yeah.
You kind of know the types you can make.
Sure.
What are some things that a DM needs to consider when crafting their dungeon?
Yeah, so I think, like, there's 2 ways to sort of approach this. You can think about it from an in-game perspective. You know, what was the original purpose of the dungeon? Is this a, you know, the stereotypical, like, dwarf hold or dwarf mine that's been taken over by orcs and then expanded? Is this a subterranean temple or tomb? Maybe it's, like, part of an undercity or something that's, mixes and blurs the lines between sewer and dungeon and city and to create sort of a great chaotic mess. The ones that we're going to be thinking of, though, would properly, I think maybe be more considered layers. Mm-hmm. These are dungeons that you can get into and out of either within a single session or within a single rest period for your adventurers, if we're talking like 5th edition here. It's one of those where you might find, you know, something that's like, say, a book of layers, right? Mm-hmm. Kobold Press puts out these books that go along with their bestiaries, where it's like, we took some iconic monsters from, say, Creature Codex, or and then, you know, created some layers for them. And these are supposed to be like, you know, one or two, maybe three rooms. It typically has like one monster and then whatever you would normally find there. And maybe it's the site of, say, a quest that you have to go on, and you know, you're slaying that monster, or you have to recover something that's in its treasure hoard or something. It's just a quick trip in, one fight and out, and that's almost like too small.
Yeah.
You know, and maybe what we're talking about here is more like a mega lair, something that's bigger than a couple of rooms, something that has more than one creature type in it, something that has the potential for secrets and the potential for like adding to the you know, the various plots and quests and narratives that you have going on. Returning to, what's the point of this dungeon? Am I putting this here to fulfill like a side quest for the party? This mm-hmm. is like the paladin is going to recover a holy relic, or the monk is going to find the burial place of their lost master or something like that? Or is this a, you know, because we, you know, we've got some players missing and we need to do something fun for tonight, so we're just going to do like a short delve and we'll return to like the main game next time, whenever it's the full room. So out-of-game considerations are something to think about. In-game, it's really about weaving these locations into the game that you have going on, and finding ways to like tie a location like a dungeon to say side quests or side goals that your players have, what they want to do for their characters, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And then like making connections between your villainous groups, what the players want to do, and then you plop it all inside one of these things, and voila. There's a potentially a fun game, fun afternoon.
That's kind of the broad considerations. Now, when it comes to the dungeon itself.
Yes.
Where does your mind start?
So my mind usually starts with some sort of inspirational material. Mm-hmm. I tend to pick a theme of some kind or two themes that I want to sort of highlight. So right here we have sort of an arcane laboratory area over here. Maybe this is a, you know, like a cloister of fire mages or something, and they have built a sort of you know, a library and study area, maybe some living quarters or guards over here. And then the deeper you get in, the more ancient it becomes, the more decrepit and ruined it becomes. And now it goes from like a group of, say, fire mages who are studying sort of elemental fire magic to like, say, fire cultists who are trying to summon elder elemental evils. And you can have that sort of depth even in a smallish dungeon. Mm-hmm. And it, you know, the first few rooms can be either themed for one sort of function or purpose or something like that, and then the deeper you get in, the more that you uncover it. Or it could be that there's like active deception going on, and it's you know, the dungeon denizens are pretending to be one thing and making a front of, you know, oh, we're just humble servants of the flame. Mm-hmm. Or you know, we're just simple mercenaries, you know, looking for a secure place to set up camp for the short term.
Uh-huh.
And then afterwards, it's only when you get deeper in and start uncovering some secrets and maybe talk to some people that you find in the dungeon that you get the full story of what's going on here.
Yeah, I totally duped my party in Starward Bound with an illithid cult.
Yeah.
Kind of the same way.
Yeah.
Yeah, there were three rooms in before they were like, oh, shit.
Yeah. And, you know, the idea is to sort of, like, get them to get in this scenario where you're sort of, like, trying to, like, actively fake out what it is that they're, you know, what it is they're doing, that maybe maybe the first few rooms, there's no enemies, there's no traps, or if there are, they're sort of, like, deactivated. Mm-hmm. Perhaps this is where you encounter, say, friendly NPCs, people to talk to, something like that. And you're sort of, like, playing against expectations. You know, the party sort of, like, they figure, hey, we're in a dungeon, like, we've got marching order and torches out and all this other stuff. If the first few living people they come across are like, hey, what's up? You know, like, can we help you? You know, is everything all right? Mm-hmm. Then that might get them to like lower their guard. Or it might be the opposite. It might like really raise their alarm bells that people just want to talk to them. So theme is a big one. You know, what sort of theme are you looking for? What kind of elements do you want to have in it? What sort of decoration? What kind of architectural style? Is it an old dusty tomb? Is it a repurposed subterranean sort of infrastructure of some kind, like a sewer or whatever? Is it a, you know, planar, something or other, planar structure that's been brought here and sort of like displaces the other things around it? What's the mood like? What's the feeling like? How well lit is it? How well kept up is it? If it has traps, who is resetting them? Who is, you know, making sure that they're well maintained? Or is it like spirits of the dead that do it? Or are they summoned demons? Maybe it's like some kind of mechanical contraption that keeps it going. All of those things are sort of anchors. And if you start with your themes and you kind of keep them in mind, then as you build your dungeon, as you run your dungeon, you can refer back to your themes and it will keep you anchored in that, like, this is what I wanted this to be about. And it kind of like can prevent, say, feature creep, or like, you know, you just sort of forget what it was that you were doing in the beginning, and it's like go off in another tangent and then realize like, oh crap, there were things I meant to put in here that I forgot to, or something like that.
Right.
What are the ways that your players can interact in the, with the dungeon? And by this, I don't mean like how do they open doors or what can they fight with, but what are the puzzles in here? What are the areas of the dungeon that say, interact with me, do something with me, ask questions about me.
Mm-hmm. And they have a faint shimmer around them.
Yeah,
just to let them know.
Yeah. There's something. So for instance, we have in this first room here, you're gonna, let's assume that the party would be coming in the main entrance here. You know, they might see, oh, they've got like, you know, there's a little shield guardian or some kind of iron golem there. But if, assuming this was empty, you come in, and the first thing they're gonna notice is these bars, and there's some sort of like statue of a bull, maybe a glowing eldritch light source or something. There's no obvious way to open this grate. And perhaps this is like a solid gold statue, right? It represents, you know, a tremendous amount of wealth.
Capitalism.
Right, exactly. Or you replace this with, you know, the magic item that they're looking for, or you replace it with, say, a person held in a stasis field. But like by the first thing that they see as they come in is an inaccessible and otherwise no obvious solution, you know, no obvious way to get into it room. You're showing it to them. It's not secret, like say this room over here where, you know, they're gonna have to move the fireplace and come back here to get to whatever this is. This is taunting them. It's telling them there is something back there you cannot get to yet. And if you're really kind of paranoid about player power, maybe these are adamantine bars or something, or there's a wall of force effect if you don't want them just busting through the wall.
I was gonna say, well, I mean, still, doesn't Misty Step go on the other side of that?
And Misty Step might go on the other side of that, unless you've got some sort of spell effect or that takes care of it. You know, this is where knowing your players, knowing what their capabilities are.
Yeah.
It could be a trap. Right? If you do have someone that can Misty Step or Shadow Step or something like that, then maybe that room is meant to lure people in with the promise of treasure.
And there's the bull wakes up.
The bull wakes up. There's a pit trap in it. There's, you know, 5 tons of sand that's going to just pour in there whenever, you know, you lift the eldritch item off of its pedestal or something. So that's sort of one example. It says, you are not supposed to just walk past me. Something is here to interact with. Is it a mystical archway that just sort of glows with an indeterminate type of magic, and you walk through it, something weird happens? Maybe not detrimental, but maybe one of those weird things where it's like a creative player could use it to their advantage if they wanted. Or perhaps there's sort of like a series of, you know, torches which, you know, you enter the room and maybe some of them are lit, some of them are not, some of them are in different places, some of them aren't, maybe some of them are turned at an angle as suggesting that they are levers to open secret doors or something. And it's the interacting with those features, especially if you do a little subverting of expectations. And, you know, if the party is thinking they're going to open a secret door with one of those levers, and it's really opening up prison cells of monsters or something like that somewhere else in the dungeon. Is there a way that they could potentially find out? Can they hear the grating of something deeper in the dungeon and the inhuman screams that issue forth as the magical barriers are broken down or something? It's a concept in action figures, and I'm not sure of the technical term for it, but it's basically like playability. It's, does this thing say, pick me up, play with me, create something out of me, make me your own. A lot of times, just an empty room doesn't really feature that. So if you want something that's going to draw your players in, you've got to think about who they are as people, what their characters might want, and then design things that are meant to pique their curiosity and don't have an obvious solution. Could be good, could be bad, could be a benefit, could be detrimental, but whatever it is not something that they're just going to walk by.
Are you ever worried about putting too much? Like you talked about describing sometimes, because sometimes dungeons, and I've been guilty of this, where my descriptions are too barren. And so then I'm like, why didn't they mess with anything? It's just like, well, I didn't really describe everything for them to know that something was off.
Right.
Are you ever worried about like too much detail, right?
I mean, certainly, yes. Like, I'm not a big fan of read aloud box text for this reason alone. There is such a thing as too much detail. I tend to prefer bullet lists of what the characters immediately see as they enter the room, and then a description after that of what might be hidden, what are some of the things that are in there, and how they interact. You know, we'll take this room as an example. You enter in this room, you see a table with some sort of model of something on it, and well-lit room here. I would basically just say there's a table, something on it, three torches lit on the walls, and that'd be it. I'm focusing on the things that are immediate, obvious, and what they can interact with, but also reminding the players, like, you can always say, I'm gonna check that archway. I'm gonna look under the table. Are there any loose flagstones? Where might there be things hidden in here? And then it's more a matter of asking the players questions, having them respond, and then clarifying, did you mean this? Is this how you're approaching it? And most of that's just based on the assumption that the adventurers are competent, but the players are not adventurers. And so, there's a difference between what they do and what their characters would do.
So when they find this model and go look at it, is that our inception moment where they look down and they're looking at a top view of the maze that they are in, and they see themselves looking into the model?
Maybe something like that,
And they look up.
Yeah.
And then look up and see the players playing D&D of the...
I love it when D&D characters break the fourth wall and realize that they're in a game. You might have that. Maybe it's an experiment, and it's full of like little bug people, and they're going through their own like dungeon. Maybe it's like a dwarven architect's idea of like beta testing something. It's just like, well, I kind of like build this out of small rocks and put some bug people in here and see how they do with it. Mm-hmm. And then, then we'll build the real thing. In terms of there being too much in a room or too much in a dungeon, yes. It's possible to get secrets that have no relevance to what's going on in the game or the themes of your dungeon. And it's just like, oh, I thought that was really cool. And then you kind of put it in there and realize it's kind of crowded. So as a general rule, usually three things per room with something in it is a good place to start. And not every room needs to have something in it. I know empty rooms are a good feature for a dungeon because they help control pacing. They can be filled later, giving a sense of dynamism to a dungeon that's going to be returned to. And they give a sense of grandeur and are a good place to have like something that features a history of the dungeon or something. An empty room is empty of enemies and threats and puzzles. It is not empty of clues. It's not empty of secrets. It's not empty of dungeon dressing. So an empty room might have a dusty skeleton of an orc that bears, axe wounds on it, suggesting that dwarves had come through here recently, or not recently, but at some point in the past and cleared the place out. Or maybe it's graffiti in a language you can't understand that speaks of threats, of a certain kind in the dungeon, something like that. You notice that there's a bunch of like scrape marks and chip marks along one of the flagstones, and it's like old crowbar marks that were used to pry it up, and you find like old, someone's old stash.
They never came back.
That they never came back for, or something. Or maybe they buried because it's terrible, and you don't want it.
That cursed gold.
Number one, secrets of that type are okay to not find. And if it's a secret that is more like a clue that would lead the party to something else, then those need to be more like obvious. Yeah. But the whole point of all of this is to create something that's coherent, something that's interactive, and something that adds to and enhances the game that you have going on. There's more like specific stuff that you can do for dungeons, but like those are the broad things to keep in mind for it.
So how the hell do you keep all that straight?
You know, for me, I've gone back and forth a lot about how I would like key a dungeon or like write it up. My preference now are short bullet point lists, nothing over a sentence long, with enough specificity that I don't have to come up with it on the spot, but mm-hmm. enough vagueness that I can change things if I need it, or react to the mood of the table or the players, you know whatever they're changing, goals or something like that. I know it's a very vague answer, but it usually means that a description for a dungeon room for me is very short, 4 lines at the most. The exceptions to this are like big rooms, like say over here, where there's a lot of moving parts. You know, there's like traps over here that look like they're, hazards for both combat as well as traps. There's summoned monsters. There's a big boss. Maybe this altar up here does something magical when the boss sorcerer, throws a special powder into it or something. There's a enemy approaching who will be joining the fight shortly. So it's like a big, complicated room where with a lot of stuff going on. I will key those dungeons up and write up those dungeon descriptions just as a way to help me run that room when the players get to it. Remind myself of little things about the bosses or the lieutenants of the dungeon, that how they might act or react. What are their priorities? What are their plans? How do they, what's their escape route if things go south?
You've gotten your players in. You've shown them a few things. How do you... You talked about maintaining pacing.
Yeah.
But how do you maintain like tension
sure.
in a dungeon? How do you build that tension?
So I think like you can start foreshadowing the types of enemies that are going to be in your dungeon. You can do that through sort of tracks. If it's a bestial type monster, maybe there's shed skin, claw marks. Maybe there's like bits of fur, scales on all the door frames, suggesting that the monster is just a little too big to get through them. And the players might be able to use that for their advantage, especially if you've got a dungeon that has like different sized doors in it. Right. So we got over here sort of a smaller door that a big monster might not be able to might not be able to squeeze through, but then like larger doors over here that are or say right here where larger monsters can get through. And maybe you've arranged your dungeon so that the bigger monsters have like avenues of attack. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, okay, these are the corridors that they can go down and hunt down. And you mark on your map, like, yeah, this is where more evidence of their passage is. And then they notice, like, maybe there's a narrow corridor, like, say, over here, where it's clean. Or actually, conversely, maybe it's really dusty, unused. And that clues the players off that, like, oh, well, the monster can't get in here, so this maybe is a safe place, or maybe leads somewhere where we can gain an advantage over it. And so, like, foreshadowing that, tracks, skin, claw marks, teeth marks, the remains of prior meals.
Yeah.
if it's something that's intelligent, then you would want to showcase that by maybe having the place be very organized. Maybe it's cleaned up. Maybe the place has been, there's been an attempt to like shore up the defenses or repair damage or something, suggesting that the people there or the creatures there are intelligent and capable mm-hmm. of sort of like planning and the like. Tension in a dungeon is largely a matter of not letting the players get too comfortable. I'm a big fan don't really provide a place for them to rest. If they want to use a spell for something like rope trick or Layman's Tiny Hut, then that's on them. Or I like a dungeon that is alive with movement, with the creatures, moving about. They're checking on things. They've got routines. A lot of this coming back to like a keying up a dungeon, I might have, let's say there's some orcs in a barracks, that's a dungeon room. And I might put on there, I'll roll a d6 whenever the players get close. And on, I might have entries that say like, well, now they're asleep. Now they're out hunting. Maybe they're cooking. Maybe they're playing. And having just like simple custom little charts or tables or something that help you sort of get in the mood for something. I like a D6 table because it provides just enough options. It just gives you a chance to showcase something different about your dungeon, to kind of like project about the inhabitants, tell the players about them, but also you might roll something that's like, yeah, they're all drunk and singing, so like the players can hear them, you know, like well before they get there, giving them a bit of an advantage and hopefully, you know, setting them up for some success. Really, the kind of the last thing that I'm thinking of for dungeons is just like a mental checklist, and it is it's something that I found online a long time ago on the Goblin Punch gaming blog. It's a checklist for dungeons that I have found extremely helpful whenever I am designing them and sort of building them, and that is to include something to steal. We could be looking at, say, a miniature, you know, a planar dungeon, which you can use to do all kinds of fun stuff with. Or you're looking to steal the Golden Gorgon and melt that corpse of a monster down for its golden scaled hide.
The Gorgonzola.
Right.
It's just made of cheese in the middle.
Yeah, so there's something to take, something to steal. There's a library full of arcane lore over here with all manner of different, you know, trinkets and baubles and the like. The second one would be something to kill. And that is something to fight, something to defeat, maybe a weak monster, maybe one that is easily overcome by good organization and good tactics, something like that. So that might be the orcs over here. Yeah, they're fierce. They're not to be trifled with, but if you keep your head about you, you fight as a group, you don't fall for any of their tricks, you probably survive against them. Having something in the dungeon that's relatively easy to defeat in combat can help lull the players into sort of a sense of everything's fine, we're going to be good. Yeah. If you do that a few for maybe one or two fights and then hit them with something that seems similar but hits a lot harder, you can kind of like shake things up that way. The other thing is to include in a dungeon something to kill you. That could be a giant elemental scorpion or a, you know, a wolf crab demon or, you know, any other kind of big nasty monster that can chase the party through the halls and put the fear in them.
Yeah.
So something like that, something that lets them know this place is dangerous. Now, if it's too dangerous, then maybe that creature is asleep or you know, they see a glimpse of it before it sees them and they understand that, yeah, something big and bad is moving through here. The fourth one would be different paths. Even the first room, we have 1, 2, 3 options for what to do at least. And that doesn't count just searching for potentially something else. If you come over here, you sort of like, there are a variety of sort of like twisting tunnels, but you can come in here to this room, you can go in here to this one up here, you can try to find this secret door and get all the way back here, or you can like, you know, come the other way and see what's over here and how the whole thing eventually connects with itself. And maybe there's, say, a secret passage somewhere in here that links all of it together as well. It's easy to design a dungeon that essentially, when you stretch it out, is a straight line.
Yeah.
And so it's one of those things where after you have the layout, just look at the flows in the dungeon. You've got your map and treat it like, say, a maze, right? Just trace, you know, a line through it of how you might get to various rooms. And if you're only looking at one or two ways through the dungeon to get to various places, that's when it's time to start making different connections, maybe add another room. They don't have to be obvious. They can be secret. It could be the reward that you found the alternative path or something. The fifth thing to kind of think about is someone to talk to. There's a reason that we have persuasion and deception and the like skills. There's a reason that bards and other social characters exist, and they can have something to do in a dungeon. And so maybe there's multiple factions in here. Maybe the fire priests attempting to summon all manner of terrible things are at odds with those who simply wish to study the elemental fire in a more detached manner. Mm-hmm. And those two factions can be played against each other. One could be allies, one could be enemies. Maybe you manipulate them both into attacking each other and you just kind of clean up the mess. But you can do that with all manner of whatever. Perhaps the fire priests here have a group of goblins that they've taken and subjugated, and the goblins are sort of like cooking and cleaning and everything else for them. Now, if a clever player might notice that the goblins are being mistreated and offer to, you know, temporary assistance, something like that. Those kinds of alliances and faction play are what what turn a mega dungeon from just being a just giant slugfest into something that's a dynamic environment in which your player's approach to how they treat the inhabitants of the dungeon matters. If they kill everything they come across, then why would anyone talk to them? But if they're known to take prisoners, if they're known to let fleeing enemies go, if they're known to just like knock them out and take their stuff and then they don't like actually kill them, then all of those things will help add into the social elements of a dungeon, which can and should be present because they make it more rich experience. And then six of seven. So the sixth one is something to experiment with. We've kind of talked about that playability and interaction, something that you know, the party can get themselves in trouble with. Maybe it's got effects that have dire consequences, or maybe it's just something that's whimsical and fun and silly. And finally, there is secrets that the players may never find. For me, let's see, the mega dungeon that I ran in the first level contained a map of the entire mega dungeon. And it was in a tomb of the builder of that dungeon. They built like on the wall or the ceiling, like just a map of all the parts of it that the builder of it had, what was like whenever they were alive. And so the map was different than the map I had. So if players ever found it, I would give them the tomb map, which would have different rooms. It would have different, some passages are now collapsed. Some passages didn't exist back then. Some rooms are cut off because of earthquake. And it would show you like, oh, well, you know, we're staring at a big cave-in. We've got the builder's map. We know that somewhere back there is another room that we could get to. And so, like, that was something that I was like, yeah, if the player, and that, to get there, the players would have to descend 100-foot cliff to an underground river and get in that river and take it about 1/4 mile downstream to where the builder had built his secret tomb in an alcove in the rock. And so, like, most players are not going to have their characters just jump in an icy river underground and just see where it goes.
Right.
But if they did, and if they just decided to, or maybe they sent their familiar down there or something, then they would be rewarded with that piece of information that would give them a significant edge.
I know what I'm doing in the next dungeon. Anyway. Now there's just going to be rivers.
Right.
I don't go anywhere. Another 10 miles. I'll find it.
That's an example of it. It could be a magic weapon, and a powerful one at that. It could be, a prisoner that, if they were released, would be a great asset to the party. But, you know, they may never find the spell key that opens the temporal prison that has the powerful golem that they could use. Or they may never discover the secrets of the miniature dungeon that they could get, or any other number of things. They don't capture the elemental fire that they came here for in the first place. The chances of failure, the chances of finding things, I know that's a tough prospect to face if you're only getting to play occasionally and you want the most rewarding experience possible. But I found that that kind of style of like always finding the thing, always winning, always defeating the enemy, will eventually get old. And the possibility of failure, the possibility of like, I can't find the thing I came here for, is what helps to build that tension that that makes these such enjoyable play experiences.
Head on over to Patreon for our weekly podcast and so much more.
Want to see us play? We've got games every week on Twitch, which we upload to our second YouTube channel, WebDM Plays.
If you like the video, hit that subscribe button, click the bell, give us a thumbs up, and tell us in the comments.
Thanks for watching.
Question, can you see my phone right now? Right here.
What about this business?
That business is not there.
What about this business?
What about this business?
What about
this business?
What about this?
To not display your groin.